Members, the next item of business on the revised order paper is a motion on review of bail policy in cases of terrorism and murder. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I'll ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this Assembly notes the recent failures in the criminal justice system to ensure that a man suspected of involvement in the murder of prison officer David Black abided by bail conditions, expresses concern at the granting of bail in this case, the low level of sureties required, and the length of time taken by the PSNI to realise that this individual had absconded, believes that terrorist suspects should remain in custody for as long as necessary to allow judicial proceedings to be completed, calls on the Minister of Justice to ensure that steps are taken to see that the suspect is returned to custody, and further calls on the Minister of Justice to take urgent steps to review bail policy in Northern Ireland, with particular regard to cases involving murder and terrorism.
Thank you. Members, before I call on Mr. Beattie to move the motion, I am sure that you are all aware there are active legal proceedings in relation to a man suspected of involvement in the murder of prison officer David Black, who has failed to answer bail. I do not want to inhibit the discussion on the operation of bail policy in cases of terrorism and murder, which is a matter of public interest. But in accordance with my responsibilities under Standing Order 73, I caution members to be particularly careful that they say nothing in their contributions in today's debate that might in future prejudice the outcome of proceedings relating to Mr. Black's murder. Members who deliberately flout the sub judice rule will be asked to resume their seats. Members should also recognise that anything they say which contributes to a substantial risk of serious prejudice to these criminal proceedings may be a contempt of court at common law, to which privilege in this House affords no defence. I call Mr. Beattie to move the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I will attempt to keep in lane, and I will attempt to keep my lurgy inside me without coughing it over the Justice Minister. So you might want to stay back. Mr. Speaker, Northern Ireland has been scourged by terrorism for far too long. Yes, it's diminished since 1998, and we had a good debate about the Belfast Agreement yesterday, but it's still here. It's beginning to feel like part of the fabric of this country, and that's extremely sad. Of course, we've tried to minimise the effects of terrorism, and we've changed the words. We call it paramilitary activity, or we call it dissidents. But they're terrorists. It is terrorism. They terrorise our communities, all our communities. And I think West Belfast has suffered far more than most. They force their will on others through a threat of violence. They shoot and they maim and they kill our elderly, our children, anybody in society in general. It is the worst of crimes because it undermines the state. It attempts to promote a cause, any cause, through terror. It must be stopped, and it must be seen to be stopped. Therefore, we must have robust structures with dealing with those linked to terrorism, or indeed those charged with terrorist offences, including strict bail conditions, or indeed stopping bail if we believe somebody is involved in terrorism. We need our independent and impartial justice system to have a look at their processes. Recently, we have seen a case of a suspect from Lurgan, a suspect involved possibly in a terrorist offence, being given leave this year to go on holiday to Spain. A suspect in the murder of prison officer Black, and I fully accept what you've said, Mr. Speaker, due to face court this year, has had his bail conditions varied. His electronic tag was removed. Having to report 7 days a week has been reduced to just 5 days a week. And last year, he was given leave to change his bail so he could go on a three-day spa holiday. That same individual has now not been seen since the 18th of November, and I'll touch on that slightly later. But can you imagine how the Black family feel at this moment in time? Completely let down by the justice system. And I'm going to put this in, unashamedly, and I mentioned it yesterday, but I'm going to do it because it's important to me. Because you have to contrast those two examples I've just given you with the contrast of a 75-year-old veteran who has been investigated twice already, has now been charged, and at 75, he's been classed as a flight risk, and he has not been allowed to vary his bail conditions. You can see that there's a perception to many that our impartial justice system needs rebalanced. The Chief Constable is under pressure on many fronts, and he and his force are doing a sterling and a fantastic job. And they are concerned about the imposition of bail conditions, and the Chief Constable said so yesterday. Their job is to gather evidence, present the evidence, and for the justice system to take the lead thereafter. If they allow bail, the justice system allows bail, then it's up to the PSNI responsible to impose those bail conditions. And the PSNI do have questions to answer. Why did it take them so long to realise that a suspect in a murder on bail had done a runner and they hadn't seen him since the 18th of November and didn't realise it until the 23rd of December? Embarrassing to say the least, and they do need to look at their structures. But I have to say that our justice system must realise as well that if they disregard what the PSNI are saying to them, then they undermine the duty of the state to protect those living in it. And what do I mean by that? If the PSNI oppose a terrorist or a suspected terrorist from going on bail and the justice system say, nah, not listening to you, we're sending them on bail, then they're undermining the PSNI and they're undermining the state. Detective Chief Constable Murray said only this month, in terms of the ability of the police to keep track of offenders according to bail conditions, is very difficult.
I understand entirely the points that's being made about the courts in their attitude to bail undermining the PSNI, but is it also not, sadly, in the instant case, an indication that the PSNI undermined themselves by not checking for over a month as to whether someone that was meant to be signing 5 days a week and hadn't signed, why they hadn't signed and where they were? So is there not a big burden on the PSNI when there are bail terms to make sure that they are imposed?
For his intervention, and you're absolutely right, and I said so as much, and the police do have questions to ask, because it's an embarrassing failure for the PSNI not to have noticed that individual had absconded and they had not seen him for over 5 weeks. So you're absolutely right, and I don't think any of us should shirk away from pointing the finger at the police and saying you must have a look at your structures, and I'm certainly in favour of that. But this motion asks to address the safeguard of our society, because the moment we have a suspect in a terrorist case, and we talked about terrorism at the very start, the moment we have a suspect in a terrorist case and we release him on bail without strict bail conditions, then we are putting society at risk. Suspect terrorists should therefore remain in custody where the evidence supports the allegation for as long as possible to allow the justice justice proceedings to be completed. Now, for me, that makes absolute sense. If the evidence is there, keep him in jail and let justice run its course. Now, for those who say the speed of justice is far too slow in Northern Ireland, well, that's a completely different issue, and I would ask for the Justice Minister to look at that and address the speed of justice. But that does not counter the fact is that we are releasing out into the country somebody who is potentially dangerous. If he was a danger to children, if he was a paedophile, we would not think twice about releasing him back out to society. We would hold him in until justice had dealt with him. And I have to say, Mr. Speaker, I view them virtually one and the same. We must review bail conditions in the case of murder or terrorist offences. Bail must be an exception. They must give the reason why they're going to give them the bail. And I would ask everybody to think that we need more stick than carrot sometimes here in Northern Ireland. Yes, of course.
I thank the member for giving way. Would the member then agree with me that the burden of proof should be on the judicial system as to why they would forego PSNI and intelligence to let these people go free on bail?
Intervention, and absolutely right, and you probably put that far better than I could have, and I totally agree with you. Yesterday, we stood here yesterday and condemned the attack on a police officer in North Belfast, and we all condemned the attack, and we stood united, and I was happy to stand with everybody in this House and condemn that attack. Well, those responsible, if caught, should not get bail. If you believe that is the case, then you must support this motion. Therefore, I move this motion. Thank you.
I call Mr. Keith Buchanan.
Speaker, I rise today to support the motion brought before the House with regard to the review of bail policies. David Black, a member of my constituency, left his home on the 1st of November, like we all did this morning, drove to his work. I worked with David on many times through the voluntary sector back in the late 1990s. He was a true gentleman, a true father, and a public servant. There are concerns from many people within our community, especially those within Mid Ulster, regarding the criminal justice system and especially regarding the case of the man accused of involvement in the murder of David Black. It was a brutal ambush, carried, planned, and carried out by terrorists and cowards who targeted and shot a family man who had over 30 years served Her Majesty's government in the prison service. Many believe bail should never have been an option for someone accused of such a serious offence. Following the recent disclosure of the breach of bail conditions by the individual charged with offences in connection with the murder of Mr. Black, I, along with my policing board colleague Nelson McCausland, sought a meeting with the Chief Constable back on the 13th of January. Myself, Mr. McCausland, and Chief Constable, and also ACC Stephen Martin, and Detective Chief Superintendent Raymond Murray, head of the Serious Crime Branch, and we were able to ask direct questions about this issue. This was the second time the bail conditions for the man accused of this offence had been questioned. During August last year, his bail conditions were relaxed to allow him to reside in a luxury hotel from the 7th of August to Tuesday the 9th of August. During this time, he was photographed along with convicted Republican terrorists at a city centre parade. It has also been reported that McLaughlin also volunteered as a steward at a dissident Republican march in Killyle on Easter Sunday. Kyle Black, son of David Black, said in August 2016 he wished his father still had his basic human right of living, never mind being able to go away on a luxury weekend break. On too many occasions, the human rights of the accused are considered. We must keep in mind the human right. Yeah, go ahead.
Grateful to the member for giving way, and given the point that has been made already about the attempted murder of the policeman in North Belfast, who I'm pleased to say is making good progress, would the member agree with me that stories such as he's outlined to this House completely undermine the public confidence in the judicial system and frankly erode that confidence on a daily basis when people hear that convicted criminals are treated in such a way by this state?
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you. Thank the member for his intervention. Yes, I would agree 100% with that. The criminal justice system does not give confidence in the community. Whenever someone is involved of an attack, as the other night in North Belfast, the law has to serve on those people and send out that signal. David Black lost his human rights on the second or the back in November. He lost his human rights. They were taken away by a card that drove up alongside the man on his way to his work. This is not the only case when bail conditions have been breached by those who have been charged with serious terrorist offences. The person charged with the murder of Adrian Misme also breached his bail conditions no fewer than five times. Five times he breached his bail conditions. These cases must be reviewed, and we need assurance from the judiciary that these failings will be investigated and addressed. Firstly, it must be stated that the police are forced to deal with the bail conditions granted by judiciary. It must not be forgotten that suspects across the rest of the United Kingdom accused of such a serious crime would not be granted bail. The granting of bail simply would not be considered in equivalent cases within Great Britain. But despite repeated breaches, it is still happening here in Northern Ireland. Whilst we recognise the difficulties faced by police, questions still remain as why action was not taken more quickly when it became clear that Mr McLaughlin had not reported to a police station. I was pleased to hear efforts had been made to track down this individual, and particularly that there had been cooperation with other police forces across Europe. It is important this issue is investigated by the police ombudsman.
Would the member agree with me that when you look at this instance and you also look at the continued segregation of dissident Republicans, that potentially the judicial system is weighted in favour of that section of this community?
I would agree with the member, yes. That section of the community seems to get a more lenient trial and passing of sentence. There's absolutely no doubt about that. The fact that the Chief Constable stated that an investigation had been started by the police ombudsman without a complaint being made underlies the seriousness of this case. Whilst this investigation will not impact the root cause of the problem and whether bail is granted, it will identify any failures in how the police have handled this case, and indeed the previous contributor referred to the 5-6 week delay in the police investigating this. Having previously raised serious concerns regarding bail conditions with the Justice Minister back in September, I have also written to the Lord Chief Justice regarding this issue. The Minister of Justice stressed in her response to my correspondence on the 12th of October 2016 that the judiciary are independent of government and that monitoring of bail conditions is a matter for the PSNI, and again, they have complete operational autonomy in the day-to-day running of individual cases and operational decisions. I will continue to press both the police and the judiciary about their actions. The public, and in particular the families of those who have suffered at the hands of terrorists,
Member, conclude his remarks.
Deserve to know that proper action is being taken to bring those responsible for such serious crime to justice. They should keep them where they belong until they stand trial, and if they are convicted, serve a time relevant to that crime. Thank you.
I call Mr Declan Kearney.
Ramaiga de Cian Corlia, agus be Sinn Féin a cainc an éadan an Runshaw umtranona anew. Thank you, Speaker. Sinn Féin will be opposing this motion this afternoon. It's now just shy of 7 years since we had the transfer of police and justice powers to the North. And that's an ongoing work in progress in terms of ensuring that our justice system is democratically reformed, that it's made transparent, that it acts in the interests of all sections of society, and most importantly, that it is predicated on a human rights framework. And unfortunately, this motion from the UUP today pushes back on that work. We're opposed not to a review in relation to bail policy, but we are opposed to the proposed blanket ban which emerges from this motion on human rights grounds in relation to anyone charged with scheduled offences or with the offence of murder. And if I can, I want to just briefly set out the context, the basis of bail law, because what must be paramount in all our minds and in this House is that for all citizens there is a presumption of innocence until proven guilty. And bail law in this place is governed by Article 5 of the European Convention on Human Rights, which protects the right of liberty and the security of the person. So no one should be deprived of their liberty in an arbitrary fashion, and the blanket ban throws up that connotation. Every individual application for bail should be judged on its own merits and should not be subject to any type of blanket ban. A prisoner on remand should be tried within a reasonable period, and every prisoner on remand has a qualified right to release pending a trial. And the difficulty is that many prisoners have experienced inordinate and unacceptable delays on remand in custody awaiting trial. And that's been highlighted by numerous judicial figures and civil liberties organisations both here in Ireland and also abroad in recent years. And it has created the perception of a form of legalised internment by remand, or by way of another description, some form of administrative detention. And the difficulty with that perception is that it directly and explicitly undermines the profile of our justice system here in the North. And it is rather ironic that this motion is being brought forward by the UUP, the very party which in fact introduced internment without trial in 1971. Yes, go ahead.
Thank you. And just at the start there, you mentioned about this seven-year journey. I'm 44 years old. I've been on a journey in this country for 44 years. We've seen no peace, no real stability in this country for 44 years. Could you tell me, as a spokesman for your party, how long this journey is going to take? Because I don't find 7 years acceptable, never mind 44 years.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you. Well, thanks for the intervention. The key, Robbie, is that we build the peace, and we build the peace together and collectively, that we restore public confidence in these institutions, and that we work together to ensure that we entrench democratic reform, the journey of change that we're all on, and that we ensure that every citizen in this society enjoys justice before the law, and that the rights of all citizens are protected under the law and on the basis with due regard to human rights. The logic of the UUP position, if considered, and I go back to what Doug said in his opening remarks in relation to
Point of order, Mr.
I understand that the Honourable Member for South Antrim is new to this chamber, but could he please refrain from not referring to members as Doug and Robbie, either by their proper title, the member for whatever constituency, or their full name?
Can I agree with the member who raised the point of order if we can refer to members by their position or by their proper title?
Okay. Look, thanks for that unhelpful intervention from the member on the other side of the House. The point that I was making is that the logic of the UUP position is that with reference to the comments earlier about the charging of the British Army veteran in connection with the fatal shooting of John Pat Cunningham in Benbourbon in 1974, is that in fact bail should not have been granted in those circumstances. That's the difficulty when we begin to take an arbitrary or a piecemeal approach to these issues. There are, of course, conditions and circumstances in which bail can and should be denied. But the court must be satisfied that there were and there are reasonable grounds for continued detention before a denial of bail can be justified. And there are potential grounds for the denial of bail, a danger that the defendant might well fail to attend for trial, interfere with evidence, interfere with witnesses, and so on. So therefore, let the court decide with judicial impartiality and not through direct political interference the terms of bail. And with respect to the police, who have responsibility for the monitoring and the governance of bail conditions, yes, they have been rightly criticised in relation to the case which has been mentioned in this motion today. Correctly criticised. And the difficulty with police monitoring of bail conditions is that it does extend way beyond this case, and it relates to their failure in their duty of care to monitor a range of defendants while on bail, and they range from alleged death drivers through to those charged with murder. And that's a real source of anger within working class communities that suffer the worst antisocial behaviour.
I ask the member to conclude his remarks.
So in conclusion, Speaker, this motion has been badly framed. It undermines the core assumptions underpinning bail law. And if its corollary is followed, its effect would be to hollow out
Member's time
the human
up.
Rights framework of our justice system.
In their contributions that sub judice rules apply to active criminal proceedings in which there has been an arrest. I call Mr. Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Responding to the very last point that you raised, I don't intend to cross any lines in respect of due process and the rule of law at any time, including in relation to the ongoing proceedings arising from the murder of David Black. And I say that for all reasons of principle, but also, if you like, for reasons of humanity, because, like other members in this chamber, I attended the home of the Black family and attended the funeral of that prison officer. And like many people in this chamber, when we travelled down the M1, heading south and west, you passed the place where that murder took place. And therefore, given that experience, I certainly won't cross lines in respect of the rule of law and due process in order to maximise the opportunities for a successful prosecution in this case for anybody who may be involved. There is a danger, and we've heard it in relation to one or two comments made in respect of this debate, that we do damage to policing and criminal justice in a way that whatever the criticisms may be of the police and the criminal justice system in this and other cases, that does extravagant damage to policing and criminal justice. In earlier interventions, there was an exchange which included that this case, quote, completely undermines confidence in the administration of justice. And in relation to a separate exchange in this debate earlier, that there was a claim that the criminal justice system was weighted in favour of one community over another when it came to sentencing and bail policy. These are extravagant claims that are not justified based upon the evidence. And whilst this case is a bad case and a hard case, and there may be others like them, we shouldn't draw conclusions about the character of the police, I will shortly, of the character of the police and criminal justice systems in the way that some of the extravagant language has suggested today. I'll give way.
And as the person who made the assertion to the House that some of the decisions in terms of bail being relaxed undermine confidence, I stand by that comment, because when my colleague from Mid-Ulster points out that criminals who are released on bail have that bail relaxed to stay in luxury hotels, attend and help organise dissident, or indeed speak and inflame people who attend dissident rallies, surely that's proof that this sort of thing can happen. I wasn't making any assertions or sweeping statements across the community and one community being giving preference over other, but clearly such actions undermine confidence, because when people come through your constituency doors or contact your office, you will see that that undermines confidence.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And yes, there will be cases in all our experience, in all our communities, that undermines confidence. But to assert on the far side of that, that it completely undermines confidence and that the criminal justice system, quote, is weighted in favour sees one section of the community getting more lenient trials than the other, these are not based upon fact, and we must base our assessments upon fact. And I agree with the upset and the exasperation around this case. I don't agree with the extravagance that some people, because in my view, the most enduring change since the Good Friday Agreement has been what was achieved in relation to policing and criminal justice. And whilst I might think that the policing change has slowed down since 2007 and that the big great work of policing reform was done between 2002 and 2007, and whilst I might want to see more radical reform when it comes to the criminal justice system, I don't take away from what has been achieved in both regards. And I certainly don't take away about the contribution that is currently being made by the judiciary in Northern Ireland in order to frame a society that upholds the right principles and applies human rights standards across the board without fear or favour. If there are issues about bail, and there are two. One is police bail, which nobody has commented upon so far, where there is a sense that when somebody is apprehended, they are given police bail too quickly. You can go into parts of West Belfast where the experience of the police and police bail in certain cases has led to a sense in the community that the state doesn't work on behalf of them and to their benefit. So the police have to tighten, in my view, their processes in respect of police bail in appropriate cases. And at the same time, the judiciary, I'm sure they hear this debate, I'm sure they've heard the criticism. I have no doubt that the Lord Chief Justice will act in relation to legitimate public concern. But that's what we should allow happen, legitimate public concern. But we should not invert the rule of law and bail procedure in the terms of the motion, where it says it believes a terrorist suspect should remain in custody for as long as necessary to allow judicial proceedings to be completed. That means that a suspect in custody for a lesser offence is not going to be granted bail.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I rise to support the motion, even though we do have some minor issues with the wording of it. For instance, calling on the Minister for Justice to ensure that steps are taken to see that the suspect is returned to custody, I think is perhaps placing an onus on the Minister which she won't be able to fulfil. I don't know what steps the sponsors have in mind beyond the obvious. Although the belief that terrorist suspects should remain in custody for as long as necessary to allow judicial proceedings to be completed, Mr. Speaker, there has to be a measure of discretion allowed to the judiciary to allow cases in particular not to be put back ad infinitum without the objection or the threat that the accused may have to be released from custody if the case is not brought forward. I note that I'm not going to defend Mr. McLaughlin in any way, but I do note that his original bail was set in May 2014, and I can't help thinking if he had been remanded in custody, we'd be having a different debate now, because to keep somebody in custody pending a trial for almost 3 years, I would query that, frankly. Anyway, he has obviously breached what were very generous bail conditions, including holiday trips. It seems to have taken the PSNI far too long to realise that he had disappeared, and as we speak, he's still at large. So with the caveat I've already mentioned, Mr. Speaker, the question is, why should a terrorist murder suspect ever have been given bail in the first place? What kind of message does this send to the family, in this case of David Black, that someone accused of complicity in the murder of their loved one should be allowed to move freely, to take holidays, to put up minimal surety, to have their tag removed, to have their conditions of reporting to the police varied in their favour, and then abscond? What message does that give to a family? This isn't the first time, as others have mentioned, the case of Adrian Ismay, the suspect Christopher Robinson, his bail wasn't revoked despite, in my opinion, two breaches. I think Mr. McGuigan said it was five. It was only finally revoked because he put something inappropriate on social media. This, I think somebody else mentioned, Mr. Speaker, this just would not be tolerated across the water. People over there don't understand why a terrorist suspect over here would ever be released on bail. Just would not happen in the UK. I know they're talking about different types of terrorists, but it just wouldn't happen. In the recent case, going back to Damien McLaughlin, he apparently disappeared in November on the 18th, and it wasn't noticed, it appears, until the 23rd of December, 5 weeks later, and a further 2 weeks elapsed before it was brought to the attention of the court. How many times was he supposed to check in during that period? So, Mr. Speaker, all this to me reinforces the thrust of the motion that terrorist suspects should not be granted bail initially, and that a full review of bail policy, which I understand that the Minister has indicated that she has instigated such a review, but that should be thorough and it should be meaningful. So I look forward to the ultra-unionist wind in this motion and the Minister's response, but I do think that the motion, in its main objective, subject to the caveats I have expressed, its main objective is to err on the side of caution the terrorist-related situations, and I think that motion is well made and is worthy of support. And I hear the comments from Sinn Féin about human rights and the European Conventions and so on. In the real world, frankly, it doesn't make sense to release terrorist suspects into the community, but I do express the cautionary note that you frankly can't keep them there forever if the case is not coming forward. I go back to it. In this particular case of Damien McLaughlin, if he was on remand in custody now, we would be having a different debate. That's 3 years to bring a case to court is too long, and that goes back to the slowness of justice that Mr. Beattie mentioned. But for all that, yeah.
Does the member agree that it's disappointing that we've come to this stage in the Assembly where obviously we are where we are, but a minister is still in post until the 2nd of March, but this review needs to be made as soon as possible in order to give those family members and those victims the confidence to say that this review will actually go forward?
Member has an extra minute.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I think I'll leave it to the minister to give us an update on the progress of whatever review she has instigated. But I agree with the point. There's a question of reassurance here for victims, survivors, bereaved family members. And I don't think our history in this is actually dealing with it very well. People, we have to err on the side of caution, but with proper safeguards. So we will support the motion.
Call Mr. Sammy Douglas.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I rise as a member of the Judges Committee to speak in this debate, and I thank Douglas Beattie for bringing this motion and his colleagues as well, and I'm certainly here to support the motion. Mr. Speaker, I was first elected to this Assembly in 2011, and during this time has been a roller coaster experience for me personally in terms of the good, the bad and the ugly. And unfortunately, there have been too many times when it's been the bad and other times ugly as well. One of the most traumatic and saddest experiences I personally experienced was visiting the home of Adrian May, the prison officer who died after a cowardly booby-trap bomb attack last March. I think it was on the 4th of March, and he died later of his injuries. I think it was on the 15th of March. It was claimed by the so-called Real IRA. And as my colleague had mentioned earlier on, the accused had broken bail conditions on 5 separate occasions. Mr. Speaker, there's been talk this morning about human rights, and I support human rights. But all I ask this morning is, what about the human rights of those families who are hearing that someone who's been accused right across the board in a number of incidents, accused of murder, attempted murder, that the courts deal leniently with them in terms of the bail conditions. And there have been a number of serious incidents linked to dissidents, well, mainly dissident Republicans, during my time as a member of the Assembly. Concerns have been raised right across the community that bail is often granted despite police objectives. The police have objected on a number of occasions.
And,
yes, go ahead.
I thank the member for giving way, and would the member agree with me that those who operate outside the law, who feel that they are above the law, should feel the full force of the law?
I certainly agree.
That's an extra minute.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I certainly agree with my colleague in terms of the full rigour of the law. This Assembly should be about tough on crime and also tough on the reasons behind crime as well. After the cowardly gun attack in North Belfast last weekend, in which a community officer suffered gunshot wounds to his arm, the Chief Constable, George Hamilton, said the criminal justice system needed linked up. He raised the whole issue of bail policy and concerns. Now, this is the Chief Constable as well as ourselves today. He went on, our job is to gather the evidence, to present that evidence to the prosecutor, for the prosecutor to take that through the courts, and for the courts to decide on things like bail and sentencing. But certainly, in the midst of his comments, there's a frustration there, and that frustration has been there for many years, not just recently. I agree with the police council. My own experience during my times in MLA has been that often at times the courts will go ahead and grant bail to people who have ended up in court on serious charges despite police objectives, even in my own area in East Belfast. Someone quoted Gandhi the other day, I think it was Mike Nesbitt or somebody. I want to quote the Apostle Paul, who said, "Abstain from all appearances of evil. Avoid the appearance of wrongdoing." And Mr. Speaker, there is a sense out there that what is happening over this past number of years, it's wrong that the courts are too lenient, even the PPS are too lenient. And what William Humphrey said this morning, it underlines the criminal justice system. I agree with William. And in closing, Mr. Speaker, I want to say that I've been here for 5 and a bit years. This is my last debate. I'm stepping down from the Assembly. And if I just, for a moment, just thank people here, I want to thank the Justice Minister here this morning. I want to thank you and your officials. But also as well, the cleaners out there, the committee staff, the people in the canteens, the security men. I think I'd like to see in the future a debate on how good the staff right across this Assembly is. They don't get the recognition they deserve. Thank you very much.
Call Lord Morrow.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I must say that we as a party will be supporting the motion before the House today. And I welcome this debate, and I think it's very right and very timely that it should happen. Damien McLaughlin is charged with aiding and abetting Mr. Black's murder, having a car for use in terrorism, preparing a terrorist act, and belonging to a proscribed organisation, namely the IRA. However, it seems this is not enough. This is still not serious enough for him to be denied bail. I have spoken and lobbied vociferously on this issue and raised serious concerns in the past over persons charged with serious offences and their bail terms. The absconding defendant has been a sharp wake-up call to all agencies involved in the judicial system. The Minister is aware that I have submitted a number of questions, perhaps more than any other MLA on this particular issue. I have also written to the Chief Constable asking the following questions. On what date was a bail breach first noted? Why was a bench warrant not sought immediately a bail breach was realised? What attempts were made to speak with the defendant's legal team to ascertain if they knew of his whereabouts? Why was action not taken to have the matter made known to the first available court sitting, as opposed to waiting until the next scheduled court hearing pending trial? Why was a statement not released earlier to the media, and indeed at the first opportunity upon a bail breach being known and unsuccessful efforts made to locate the defendant? Which agencies were advised of the position and on what dates? In addition, on what date were ports, airports and the Garda Síochána alerted to this case? To date, I have received an acknowledgement, but I have received no details to any of those questions. In reference to the list of court appearances, the defendant, since he was first charged on the 20th of December 2012, now imagine we're going back to 2012, when he was initially remanded in custody. Now just think about the date. 20th of December 2012, that's over 4 years ago, pushing on now for the fifth year. The previous minister contended significant moves were underway towards speeding up justice, but that does not fit in this and many other cases which I have taken an interest in. Due to the inordinate length of time, this case was taken by May 2014. McLaughlin successfully applied for a lease at High Court citing human rights legislation on the grounds he had been held in custody too long. The judge in question was required to consider bail favourably and indeed did so. On the 18th of December 2014, the defendant successfully applied for a trial variation. 3 months later, on the 30th of March 2015, a further variation was granted. All in all, the judge clearly looked at the defendant's appearing to be conforming with bail terms, and each variation was relaxing the very safeguards designed to protect the due process. But then it appears carelessness set in and compliance was exploited. And none of us, including the victim's family, who are the most important people here, have been treated absolutely shamefully, are given any cognate explanation. Two factors, in my view, contributed greatly to this matter. The first is a ridiculous length of time in getting to trial, often delayed in part by the utilising of preliminary investigations at the behest of the defence, and it's not the first time I've raised this issue. Something I have been lobbying long to be abolished, as this is the only part of the United Kingdom that I'm aware of that continues to use them. The second is the fact that bail under human rights legislation appears to be granted. Not much regard given for the black family rights. I want those, and furthermore, when I challenged Sinn Féin, where they stood on this issue, what was their response? That's a police matter. We don't comment on those things.
Members, time is up.
Not half they don't.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And on this, the last day which this Assembly will meet in this place, I thank my colleague, Mr. Doug Beattie, for proposing this important motion before us today and express my deep concern and share the anger of many people from my constituency of Mid Ulster at the management of the bail conditions of this man who was charged with offences linked to the terrorist murder of my constituent prison officer, David Black. I was shocked to learn through media reports that the accused in this case has not been seen by the police since November. It is absolutely disgraceful that this man was allowed to disappear while on bail. Indeed, as we have previously heard, this is a man that already made headlines when the authorities previously allowed him to attend a spa break in Fermanagh. The facts of the case have been rehearsed already. It emerged that having failed to sign with police on the 18th of November, it was not until the 23rd of December when police called at his bail address to find that the flat had been cleared out. And in fact, evidence suggested that he had been gone a few weeks by that stage. Mr. Speaker, the accused was supposed to check in at a police station 5 times a week, yet he had not been seen by police in 7 weeks. Over time, judges had cut the number of days per week the accused had to sign with the police from 7 to 5 and ordered that his electronic tag be removed. It goes without saying that he must be returned to custody immediately. Unfortunately, those responsible for this inexcusable situation have demonstrated a total lack of respect toward the family of the late David Black. I am regularly in contact with the Black family, and I know that they feel, as Kyle Black said publicly, let down, hurt, and betrayed by the justice system. My thoughts are with the Black family, who have been put into the public eye once again due to the failings of the judicial system, the very system in which David served so faithfully. The appalling failings in this case have understandably caused much anger across Mid Ulster, an area which has suffered more than most at the hands of terrorism. Faith in the justice system has been damaged, particularly amongst victims. Unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, this case is not the only example of a man charged in connection with a terrorist murder being allowed to breach his bail conditions. Christopher Robinson, the man charged with the murder of prison officer Adrian Ismay, was granted bail in May 2016. But was subsequently rearrested again a number of times for allegedly failing to comply with terms set by the court. Again, this should not have been allowed to happen, and our thoughts must also be with the Ismay family for the hurt that has been caused to them by these failures. To allow this type of situation to occur once could be seen as being careless, but for it to happen twice within the same year is clearly evidence of a culture which needs to change and a policy which needs to change. Bail is seemingly too easily given out and not stringently enough managed, and there does not seem to be any understanding of the sensitivities of cases involving murder and terrorism. There needs to be a strong deterrence with regard to the breach of bail conditions, and the public should not be put in danger by the lax supervision of suspects. The rights of the accused appear to take precedence over the rights of the families of the victims in these cases. And of course, this causes people to question just whose side is the justice system on? There is an argument that suspects have an entitlement to bail due to the length of time they spend on remand. However, the answer to this must be to speed up the process of administering justice and not to grant bail in such cases. It is my firm belief that terrorist suspects should remain in custody for as long as is necessary to allow judicial proceedings to be completed. Mr. Speaker, I find myself astounded at the events referred to today. Terrorist suspects and anyone involved in murder cases should not be granted bail unless in exceptional circumstances. Recent events have had a very negative effect on trust and confidence in both police and the criminal justice system. Indeed, the system is not working and needs change. I refer to today's newsletter article about bail policy concern, in which the Chief Constable, in reference to the distant threat,
conclude her remarks.
And members will be able to read that for themselves, but I join my colleagues in the call for the Justice Minister to reflect on the failings clearly identified and urgently review policy and in a joined up approach. Thank you.
Mr. Paul Frew.
Speaker, and I rise to support the motion here before us today, and what is a very, very serious matter. Something of concern out there in the public. This is one of those issues that has a real burning in our community at this present time. And people want to know why things have went wrong and why things are broken. Mr Speaker, I've been the chairperson of the Justice Committee now since the last election. And I must say I've learned a lot in that time, having previously been on the committee, of course. I learn more, I think, as chair, and I meet more people in more one-to-one situations. And I have the utmost respect for the Justice Minister of that time, Clare Sugden. And I also have the utmost respect for the Lord Chief Justice and all the judiciary and all the organisations and functions of the judiciary. But we are public representatives. We speak on behalf of the public, and at the present time, this is a massive issue in our communities. There is absolutely no doubt about that. And I hear what members have said, and I don't believe that us debating this issue here today will damage in any way the criminal justice system or the confidence in the policing. I think it would do an injustice to those bodies if we didn't debate something that was very, very topical out there in our public. Because we have to try and fix it. And we as politicians surely have a role to play in trying to fix that system. It is not good enough to say that we shouldn't talk about this. These people are independent of political interference. That is correct. And that's something I will uphold as long as I'm a politician. But we also, in this House, set law. And we also ask the judiciary to implement that law. And it's only right that we should look at policies around bail. That's quite satisfactory and open. And I'm sure the Lord Chief Justice would actually welcome that. And any other investigations or inquiries or laws that we bring in here to this House, that's our function. But I must say, it really annoys me when Republicans and Nationals talk with forked tongues about moving on a journey and about making it right and about having maximum confidence in police, when they'll say all these good things to entice unionists into thinking that the United Ireland would be some sort of utopia, some great place to live, when we all realise that it wouldn't be. But then the very next day, they will stand side by side with hardliners, with placards outside Knock HQ, demanding the release of some prisoner for whatever. These people who have been charged need to be managed very, very carefully. It is true to say that people are concerned about low levels of sureties required for bail. The length of time taken for the PSNI to realise that someone has absconded. And the question I'd put to Sinn Féin is this: why have you been quiet on this issue? What if Mr. McLaughlin has disappeared? Disappeared. Does that not concern Sinn Féin? We've had a past history of disappearance. I'm putting that out there. I'm putting that out there.
Will
the member give way? Yes, I
will. Yeah. Would the member agree with me that this issue and issues we've debated earlier on this morning, yesterday, these are major issues that are going to be left aside, and there's an onus on all the MLAs coming back here to sit down, crack a few heads and get this resolved, because we're going into a black hole here, and I doubt personally why we'll ever come back again to this assembly.
The member has an extra.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Yes, I agree with my colleague Sammy Douglas on that point. We aren't coming back here anytime soon. We have seen a massive sea change in the demeanour and the attitude of Sinn Féin members, even in the last couple of weeks, even in the corridors, even in the canteens. We have seen it. We're not coming back here anytime soon. And you know something? I don't want to come back here to a place where one party can walk away and try and hold to ransom the institutions of this very country. We're not coming back to that. Let me tell you that now. But what happens when a terrorist absconds? They go on the run. And isn't it not sexy for a terrorist to be on the run? Have we not seen throughout the years how folklore has developed when terrorists go on the run? Now, I don't see anything sexy about lying in a cattle shed on a concrete slab or an attic of somebody's or a sympathiser's house. To me, that's not sexy at all. But this is how these people think. And then in a couple of years' time, we'll realise they're in Colombia or in America or in Cork. And then they'll be lauded in a public meeting in West Belfast or Dublin, and people will cheer, and there'll be fists raised in pumps. That's not the sort of society I want to live in. That's not the sort of society I want my children to live in. And I would ask Sinn Féin and the Republican movement, wise up.
Call Mr. Raymond McCann.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Frew has just referred to people campaigning with placards demanding the release of this one and that one, and he characterised this as standing side by side with extremists. It is not standing side by side with extremists to call for the release of anybody. Certainly not. I hereby repeat my call for the release of Tony Taylor. Tony Taylor is a Republican from Derry. He was released under the Good Friday Agreement, was arrested again early last year. He's presently in McGabbery Prison. He was arrested because the then Secretary of State, Theresa Villiers, signed a document saying that she believed that he was involved in activities which were proper and acceptable to send him back to prison. Ask what were these activities? I'm not telling you. Who gave you to believe that he was involved in these activities? The security services. Did they give you the information? Yes, they did. Will you tell us? No, we will not tell you. What am I to say? What is anybody to say to Lorraine Taylor, Tony Taylor's wife, who doesn't know how long he's going to be in? It's open-ended. Will it be a year, 2 years, 3 years? And his wife and family are not told why. Mr. Speaker, this cannot be right. It cannot be right that citizens are detained by the state without that citizen or anyone else being given a reason why. Due process has to mean something, Mr. Speaker. And let us look back to the occasion in our history, certainly our recent history, in the last half century, when the denial of liberty to citizens without charge or trial resulted sort of in a booster shot to violence sort of in Northern Ireland, such as we have had from no other particular incident. I'm referring, of course, to internment sort of in 1971. Occasionally here and outside, we refer to the major atrocities which have taken place. Atrocities, and I include, of course, just for the sake of the record, in case anybody suggests I would think otherwise, I include, you know, Inniskillen, I include Tyburn, I include the dreadful sort of an unjustified and unjustifiable atrocity in Birmingham in December 1974, when innocent people were blown to bits. So when I talk about atrocities visited upon citizens, I am not being exclusive about it. But I am saying that sort of our horror at such things, our empathy with the grief of those lost behind, must not spill over to saying that any measure is acceptable to deal with this sort of thing and to stop this sort of thing. Actually, it doesn't stop this sort of thing. Because the main conclusion we could draw from the introduction of internment without trial all those years ago is that it didn't stop any deaths. It didn't stop terrorism, however you define it. On the contrary, it gave a boost to it. Think of the atrocities that I mentioned before. What I had in mind is Ballymurphy. Ballymurphy happened on the 10th and 11th of August 1971, in the immediate aftermath of internment. Think of Bloody Sunday. The Bloody Sunday march was a march against internment. It was a march for due process. It was a march with people with a placard saying, we want we want somebody to be charged and tried before they're put in jail. We can't have it on the basis of a government at Stormont or Westminster or anywhere else saying, we think this is a dangerous person, so we think that they should be put into prison. And I'm struck by the fact, that none of those who have spoken in favour of this motion have even admitted that this might be a difficulty. You see, when you talk sort of when you talk about those responsible, if they are caught, they shouldn't be given bail. How do you know those are the people responsible if they haven't been taken to a court and the evidence produced against them? I am sorry that nobody in proposing this motion have admitted that there is a grave difficulty involved, even from not from a left-wing point of view or a Republican point of view, but simply from the point of view of ordinary common or garden justice. There is a problem here. We could argue again about what the solution to the problem is, but it simply wasn't acknowledged. That says something ominous about the attitudes we have towards people. So, yep.
The member be concerned at the tone of the debate suggests that the justice system is balanced against one community, but does he agree that it ignores the reality of the fact that stop and search happens predominantly in what's perceived to be nationalist communities, particularly in North and West Belfast?
That's certainly a perception, and of course
the member has an extra minute.
Thank you very much. When there is such a perception, when the perception is based upon material reality, that's a real problem. That's a real problem for law and order in any society. So just in this sort of, we voted for the motion yesterday, sort of in relation to the killing on the Crumlin Road. And we did that sort of because we're actually the strategy of armed struggle, as Republicans call it. Sort of, we're not against it since the Good Friday Agreement. We're saying that it was always wrong. It was always futile. It was never going to deliver anything commensurate with the investment of pain inflicted as well as endured. It was never going to deliver a return commensurate with that. We were against it from day one, and we're still against it. So the remarks that I'm making today, and standing up for civil liberties, and standing up for the bail conditions, as they normally. Thank you very much. It doesn't associate me with armed struggle or anything else, but it associates me with basic principles of justice.
I call Mr. Jim Allister, and before the member speaks, I have to inform him he has 4 minutes.
There patently is a systemic problem in the administration of bail, and I think there are proper criticisms to be made arising from the case which most recently evidenced that problem, the McLaughlin case. But I think we do have to recognise where the source of this problem is. The source of this problem is the European Convention on Human Rights, because the European Convention under Article 5 creates a presumption in favour of bail, and the prosecution then has to displace that presumption by proving that one of five matters are a good reason to deny bail, such as may abscond, may reoffend, may interfere with witnesses, etc. And it is that tilting of the balance in favour of the person accused and against the police which has created the situation that has evolved. Now, our judges have to work with that. I do have a criticism of our judges, and I think that in Northern Ireland, in contrast I perceive with elsewhere in the United Kingdom, they are more timid and more generous in terms of their attitude to the European Convention, and therefore more generous in their granting of bail. And I think the Justice Minister could do a useful piece of work by having a study conducted as to comparing and contrasting the attitude to bail, which operates under the same European Convention in Northern Ireland as opposed to GB. Because I think, and Ben Rari, journalist, has done some good work on this, which is insightful and indicates there is a problem, and I think the Justice Minister could do could have a good piece of work done in that. So really, we have to go to the source, and we have to go to the source in recognising that not for the first time the European Convention on Human Rights has got its balance wrong, and that if the United Kingdom government reviews the Human Rights Act, then that would be one fruitful area where they could and should review its operation. Because I'm told I have no extra time, so not on this occasion. Sorry about that. But so I think that yes, we need to carefully scrutinise what our judges are doing. I do think they're too generous in their interpretation. And then we have to properly ensure that when bail is granted, it is policed. Because one of the most scandalous things about the subject case is the indifferent attitude to the policing of that bail, and how that person was able to be away out of this jurisdiction, we presume, for a month before anyone realised. What was the point in asking him to sign 5 days a week if no one was following up on the fact that he hadn't signed? That is a scandalous dereliction of duty. And the other contributor to too much free bail is the delays in criminal trials, which accentuates the burden on the judiciary to give bail.
I call the Minister for Justice to Claire Sugden to respond.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. I welcome today's motion and debate. I thank the tablers of the Ulster Unionist Party for bringing this to the House. I think generally I understand and I appreciate and certainly sympathise with the ethos of this particular debate. There are a number of certain aspects that would make it difficult for me to support. That said, I think coming from the premise of the victims, which is something that I've always championed as Justice Minister, I am indeed sympathetic to the motion of this debate. The motion was concerned with bail issues, which is an important aspect of the justice system, but it is also important that this Assembly sends some crystal clear messages to our justice family and to the community they serve. Whilst this might seem out of context, Mr. Deputy Speaker, if you would allow me to reiterate some of the points that I made yesterday. Spraying a Garge forecourt with an automatic fire is sickening. Shooting at young officers in a public place is nothing short of repulsive. Putting the public at risk and a community in fear is not in the furtherance of a political cause. It is an act of wanton aggression. And I want to send two very clear messages to our justice colleagues and to our community. To our justice colleagues, I say, we support you in your work. We welcome what you do to keep us safe, and we are grateful and indebted. To our police officers, keeping people safe. To our prison officers, working hard to rehabilitate offenders. To our probation officers, court staff, and everyone in the justice sector, I say thank you. And this whole Assembly, I would hope, wants you to know that you have our support. To the officer injured on Sunday night, to his colleague who was with him, to the first responders, and to the officers investigating this crime, again, we send our heartfelt best wishes and indeed thanks for the work that you do to protect our community from harm. Yes, sure.
Minister, you alluded there to North Belfast, and I was going to ask the Minister, would she look at the statements by the Chief Constable, who's questioned just the linkages that may be undermining
the whole criminal justice system in terms of situations like that. And also just want to pay tribute to you. I think you've been a great minister. All this dumped on your young shoulders, I think you've done an excellent job. Thank you very much.
I thank the member for his intervention and kind wishes. He's going to have me filling up. But I have very much acknowledged what the Chief Constable has said in relation to the events that happened in North Belfast yesterday. You know, from the outset, I've never shied away from the fact that the criminal justice system does need looked at. We do need to value or re-evaluate what we need to do to better serve the public in Northern Ireland. I'll get on to some of those areas that I, as Justice Minister, was keen to try and progress, but albeit I've been limited in the time that we have, but you know, we can see what happens in the next mandate. But certainly, I appreciate the member comments. Comments about yesterday, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I want to thank the community as well for their support expressed for the officer, his family and colleagues, because I think we need to send a united message in this Assembly and across Northern Ireland that we reject those who want to take us back to the past, because they need to realise, Mr. Deputy Speaker, it's over. It's over. No one wants the activity that they're trying to bring forward. I am sickened not only by the injuries inflicted on this officer, but I am sickened by what might have happened in a public place with citizens going about their business in a garage on a main road. It is beyond any rational explanation. There is no possible logical narrative which justifies what happened on Sunday night. Mr. Deputy Speaker, I will return to the detail of the motion because it raises some important issues which absolutely resonate with the current situation and what's happened in the past couple of days, which is why I saw fit to relay my concerns about that. The motion has been tabled following the disappearance of an individual who was on bail and charged with a serious offence. The public is concerned about this case, and rightly so. This Assembly is concerned, and so am I as Justice Minister. And I have written to the Lord Chief Justice and the Director of Public Prosecutions and the Chief Constable about this particular issue. Because, as I said, we are right to be concerned. This case is connected to the murder of prison officer David Black, a public servant murdered in the line of duty. His family, friends and community have lost their loved one. The prison service has lost a colleague. And I welcome the fact that today's debate has given us an opportunity to extend again our heartfelt sympathies to the family of David Black, not only for their loss, but the ongoing hurt they will feel, and indeed the hurt that they will still feel because we are debating this and talking about their loved one today. The only person charged in connection with David Black's dreadful murder can now not be found. He was due to be tried in accordance with his right, but as of today, the justice system cannot produce him for trial. There are reviews underway. The PSNI and the Police Ombudsman are both looking into these issues, and I welcome that because that is indeed necessary. And there will be lessons to be learned, I am sure, and I almost hate using that phrase because I think we need more than that, because there are broader issues for the justice systems to reflect on. It is entirely right to ask whether it is focusing on delivering for victims and indeed defendants, for communities and citizens. It is legitimate to reflect on whether it has the right structures, the right priorities and a meaningful connection with the people it serves. And this is something that I indeed was giving much thought to. I had already announced a review of courts, which I referred to as Courts 2020. I had made progress on areas of responsibility under the Fresh Start Executive Action Plan, and I had made tackling domestic violence and abuse my top priority. This motion focuses on bail, however, and it is my strong view that improvement to the operation of the bail system cannot be made without wider systemic improvements to the criminal justice system as a whole. This is why my department's work under the Speeding Up Justice programme, which touches on bail-related issues, is so vital. Speeding Up Justice is delivered alongside justice partners. It incorporates legislative reform as well as operational improvements consisting of administrative and procedural reforms. These reforms are crucial, and the Justice Act 2015 is integral to delivering them across a number of priority areas to help speed up justice. We are now, thankfully, finalising plans to implement these major provisions. Changes initiated by the introduction of Sections 88 and 93 of the Act, which deal with early guilty pleas and PPS summons respectively, have already come into operation and are effective since 1 April 2016. The PPS summons changes in particular will help streamline procedures and reduce the time taken to issue and serve summonses, contributing to the overall measure to speed up justice. Work is also ongoing to finalise regulations to enable the provisions on statutory case management, with implementation scheduled to be in place by September this year. The regulations will impose duties on the prosecution, the defence and the court in terms of the management of criminal cases, with a view to ensuring that cases are progressed in the most effective way possible, whilst maintaining a focus on the paramount need to secure justice. Subsequent regulations will impose a general duty on anyone involved in criminal proceedings to reach a just outcome as swiftly as possible. This approach couples a statutory change in working practice with a requirement to work towards speedy and just outcomes, and I believe that this will have a positive impact on the whole justice system, including bail, which can be affected by case delays. In my programme since becoming Justice Minister, I had a focus on people, on women and young people in justice, on the harm and vulnerabilities we see in the justice system, whether that be offenders, victims or indeed justice practitioners around mental health issues, on older people and the fear of crime, on those living in our rural communities. This has been my focus and I had planned to speak in more detail about these issues today. I had started to think about the performance of the overall system in the context of today's citizens' expectations, about confidence and about harnessing the invaluable efforts made by all those who work so hard in law enforcement and the justice system every day. To make a deeper connection with the problems faced by citizens through the programme for government, and to start a process whereby outcomes and confidence would be central and valued above processes and practice and structures through my problem-solving justice initiatives. But these are issues, regrettably, for another day. Mr. Speaker, I should also like to, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I should like to say something for the record about the bail regime and how it works, because I do think it is important how we outline how bail is currently worked. It is indeed how Mr. Alistair has described. The operation of the bail framework is underpinned primarily by Article 5 of the European Convention on Human Rights, the right to liberty and security. Article 5 requires that a person charged with an offence must be released pending trial unless there are relevant and sufficient reasons to justify continued detention. The starting point for all pre-trial remand decisions is the presumption of innocence, and this is a fundamental tenet of the protection in the law and is consistent with the principle of the right to a fair trial. Bail can only be refused if one or more of the 5 broad conditions have been met, and I'm quite happy to outline these conditions. They include the risk that, number one, the accused will fail to appear for trial if they are released on bail. Number two, the accused will interfere with the courts of justice while on bail. Number three, they will commit further offences while on bail. Number four, they would be at risk of harm against which they would be inadequately protected if released on bail. And number five, if they pose a risk to the preservation of public order if the accused is released on bail. So Mr. Alistair is entirely right that one of those 5 has to be satisfied in order to refuse bail. At the time when anyone, and that would be at the time of their first being granted bail or not. The grounds for refusal do not include that the accused has been charged with a serious offence, although naturally the seriousness of the offence may be a factor in determining if one of the 5 grounds for refusing bail exists. I have been clear that... Sure.
Is one of the concerns in the implementation of that it there appears as time goes on and someone is longer in custody, that the courts become easier satisfied on the granting of bail? They may have refused it on the basis that this person might interfere with witnesses or not turn up, and then suddenly, a year down the line, they release that very person that hitherto they'd made those findings against because they've been longer in custody. Is that not a concern, that it seems to dilute the requirements as time goes on?
I thank the member for his intervention. I am concerned that the longer people are in custody, it does make it more difficult to satisfy certain conditions, and indeed there are issues around remand that Mr. McCann has also alluded to. And I think essentially we need to speed up justice, but we also do have to look at how bail conditions are applied. And indeed, you know, I am quite happy to take Mr. Alistair's suggestion that we do a comparative model to see if there are differences about what's happening between here in Northern Ireland and GB. I have been clear, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that it is not my role as Justice Minister to comment on the availability or conditions of bail in this specific case that has prompted the debate. These are essentially matters for the court. Every application for bail is unique and depends on the relevant factors relating to the individual circumstances of the offence and the accused. That is why it is right that it is for the independent and impartial judiciary to make decisions on the granting of bail. I do, however, recognise that there is the perception that bail may be more readily available in Northern Ireland than in other jurisdictions in the United Kingdom, which is why I'm quite happy to take forward Mr Alistair's suggestion around doing a comparative model so we can be fully informed should this issue be raised in the next Assembly. It is recommended a review to determine the facts and, if required, bring forward measures to improve the situation. And as I've already said to this Assembly before, this review is currently underway. It will establish facts about the bail decisions in Northern Ireland, and it is an important review. And I do not want to speculate or preempt its outcome, but I would hope that we would find a conclusion to that in the coming weeks. But it is vital that Northern Ireland has an effective framework for bail that appropriately balances the needs of defendants, victims and the wider public. And so I have asked my officials to do all they can to complete this work as soon as possible, as I said, in the coming weeks. Where concerns or areas for improvement are identified, a second phase of work will be taken forward to address these. Mr Deputy Speaker, as I said, I welcome today's debate on the substantive issues raised in this motion, but I also recognise and welcome the fact that this Assembly has been concerned with other matters too, concerned about our justice colleagues and the community they serve, and this is the vital message that we send out. And indeed, when this next Assembly resumes, and hopefully it will be sooner rather than later, you know, I would encourage all members of this House to focus on the issues that do matter to the people on the ground. And indeed, this motion today is one that has captured the interest of the general public, because it concerns their safety and the safety of their loved ones, and I think that's what we should be putting our focus on today. So it has been my pleasure to respond to this motion. Thank you.
Call Roy Beggs to wind the debate on the motion, please.
Thank you, Mr Deputy Speaker. There is widespread concern at our criminal justice system in Northern Ireland at the bail conditions and indeed some of the sentences that have been given to those who have been involved in violent and terrorist activity. And it's important that everybody appreciates that, because if we are to retain public confidence in our justice system, they must have a feeling that it is fair and proportionate and doing everything that is reasonable to protect them. Whether they are violent dissident Republicans or the South East Antrim UDA involved in a feud within my constituency, we need the same standards of justice delivered to everybody. We're not asking that it should be picked out for one group or another, but the public do need to be protected. The Fresh Start Agreement set up a three-person panel to report on the disbandment of paramilitary groups in Northern Ireland, and they produced a report dated May 2016, some 7 months ago. And there are two relevant paragraphs within it that I wish to highlight to people who haven't been mentioned to date. Paragraph 419, the Department of Justice, the Courts Service, Public Prosecution Service should implement the case management improvements throughout Northern Ireland, particularly in respect of offences linked to terrorism or organised crime groups, recommendation A12. This is an issue that has been mentioned by my colleague Sandrine Overend, Lord Morrow, Trevor Lunn and even the Minister. But what has been the progress on it? There's also another relevant paragraph to bail conditions, paragraph 452. If I might just turn it up. And then it advises that the UK government, the executive, law enforcement agencies working with their partners in Ireland should ensure that tackling organised criminal activity is an integral part of their efforts to deal with Northern Ireland related terrorism. We need to ensure that we are working consistently. So I would acknowledge that some of the issues have been highlighted, but it appears that we're going forward very, very slowly. And I know wheels of justice can be slow, but the wheels of the review of justice seem to be even slower. And because of that, and my disappointment at the lack of progress, I put down a number of Assembly questions, and I have to say the answers which have just come in this month are even more disappointing. When I asked the Minister what meetings have been held in connection with this and a review of to offer bail and give guidance, the Minister has advised, "I have not had meetings about offering bail or guidance for setting bail conditions in specific cases." I wasn't asking about specific cases, I was just asking for general conditions. And we also were advised that a workshop has been arranged for 15th of February 2017. But remember, that report came out in May 2016. We are moving far, far too slowly. I also asked the question about the difference of bail conditions. And this is another issue that has been highlighted by members in the course of the debate. And then the Minister has indicated that bail law in Northern Ireland is a mix of common law and statute, whereas in other places it is a consolidated, there is consolidated bail legislation. So there's a lack of a single bail act in Northern Ireland. She's also indicated that in England and Wales they have a reverse presumption, that is, that bail will ordinarily not be granted to some where a defendant's been charged with offence of murder or attempted murder, manslaughter, rape or serious sexual offence, or if she has previous, he or she has previous conviction for the same offence, where the defendant has been charged with an indictable offence. So we seem to be operating all under the European Court, but legislation is deemed to be satisfying it in England and Wales, which deals severely to try and protect the public with those involved in violence in England and Wales, not so in Northern Ireland, and we need that change. Turning now to some of the comments of those who have addressed us today, thank Doug Beattie for bringing this motion forward. He has pointed out that terrorism is continuing and we need to give a consistent message against it. And he highlighted in particular, and it's very poignant this week, with that violent attack on police officers in North Belfast just this week. And we need to be thinking about how are we going to deal with those who hopefully will be charged and brought to courts, to the criminal justice system with that murder. Are we going to give it the seriousness that it deserves? And I agree with them that we need to question why bail should be given in such situations. And where bail is given, clearly there needs to be very strict bail conditions and need to be rigorously implemented. So then, turning on to some other aspect, he again contrasted that in this particular case with someone accused in relation to the murder of prison officer Black, David Black, that bail conditions were offered, but contrasted that with a 75-year-old veteran who wasn't allowed for variation of bail conditions to go on holiday. You would not think that a 75-year-old veteran would be a high risk of seconding to some other jurisdiction. And so the public is concerned at the inconsistency within our criminal justice system, and a single bail act may actually help that. And again, the police, in connection with this, clearly there needs to be a major review, and I welcome that that has gone on, and we wish to hear a more definite outcome to ensure that when someone breaches their bail conditions on the 18th of November, that it will not be until the 23rd of December that somebody spots that they've breached their bail conditions. If someone is required to sign up to the station, the day that they fail to do so should be notified as a breach of bail condition. Again, I noticed that Keith Buchanan also highlighted the case of someone charged in connection with Adrian Isney, that they breached their bail conditions five times before bail was revoked. Certainly.
I thank the member for giving way. The signatories to the 98 agreement, I think everybody can agree, brought forward an amazingly inclusive political process. And 19 years on, the attempted murder of the police officers this week proves that there are those who will never accept the inclusion and choose to exclude themselves. And I hope the member would agree, I think that proves that the public deserve maximum protection and demand action, not words, action that ensures we give primacy to the human right to life above those who try to deny it. And if that means tightening up bail, so be it. It was the choice of those who committed the criminal acts.
I thank you for that intervention, and it moves on nicely to the next contributor that we had that was going to refer to Declan Kearney, who was saying how you can't tighten up bail conditions because of the Human Rights Act. Let us remember the human rights are balanced. It's rights and responsibilities, and we must also protect the rights of ordinary citizens who will be exposed to risks of those who are accused of being involved in terrorist activities, if they are released, and if they are released in some very flimsy bail conditions, which they in turn ignore. Alex Atwood shared sympathy with Prison Officer Black and visited the family. And he highlighted that there is damage being done to the criminal justice system, but he did point that it does have to be balanced. Trevor Lunn, then, when talking about the justice, indicated support for a motion. I thank him for that. He did also highlight this issue of the excessively long time that it's taken to bring this case forward to court, and that is a valid concern. And our court service and our justice system must get that sorted out, because that may well have contributed to this case. And as I've said, this was highlighted in May last year, and what has happened? Very little, it would appear. We need to move forward and make sure that we do not get to such a situation where those accused of serious offences are being granted bail. Lord Morrow again highlighted this case of the unusually long length of time before the case is coming forward. And again, that's very valid. I'd like to thank my colleague Sandra O'Brien for sharing the concerns of the Black family and her constituents at the release, and how this has brought this case to the fore again. I thank her and others that I haven't managed to mention for their contributions during the debate.
Okay. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
No. Okay, clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Okay. Members, please resume their seats. Order. Order. Members, resume their seats. The question now is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye. Aye. No. Contrary. No. Okay. Do we have tellers? Okay, members, order please. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes, Doug Beattie and Sandra Overend. Tellers for the noes are Declan Kearney and Declan McAleer. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide ayes to my right, noes to my left. Okay, order, members, please. If members would resume their seats for the result of the vote. Clerk, would you read the result, please?
Simple majority division result. 84 members voted, 51 members voted aye, 33 members voted no. One member who voted in both lobbies is not included in these results. The motion is carried.
Okay, the motion is carried. Would we unfasten the doors, please?